Thank you for joining Auto Network. This is Roosevelt, and we're into our last show, our final show for 2023. 2023 has been an exciting year in the automotive space, as you probably all know. And as usual, you can find us on blackpressusa.com, and I always say, please like, follow, and subscribe to all the panelists' social media sites. And if you know an African-American male that's 30 years or older, please make sure he visits that urologist, get the PSA exam. It's that little prick that could possibly save his life.
I mentioned in the green room, Roosevelt, I tested positive for COVID Christmas morning. So I had Christmas by myself, which is how my wife preferred that. So, we'll celebrate later.
But anyway, let's get right into the show for today. We're going to have some reviews from the panelists. The last press car of the year for most of us. Yeah. And let's get some thoughts on that. And then we'll talk a little bit about 2023, our thoughts on it, maybe some suggestions or some projections for 2024. So, Dawn, why don't you kick it off? What are you driving?
2023 Toyota Corolla Hybrid SE. It's really cute, really fun, really fuel efficient, which I love. And I love the color Ruby Flare Pearl. It's called Ruby Flare Pearl, but it's like a reddish or burgundy color. It's really cute. The JBL sound system sounds really good. I feel like they really upgraded that, because when I first started testing out Toyota a few years back, I was not pleased with that sound system at all. But I really like it now. Starting price is $23K. Price tested, which is the SE. Like I said, it's $26K, just a little bit above that. Miles per gallon combined 50, which is awesome. I don't think I felt that or had to go to the gas station when I had that car and I had it for a week. So that's pretty cool. So yeah, so that's the one.
Okay. Teia.
I'm in the backseat of the 2024 Defender.
Now, wait a minute. Let's clarify that.
Because I was at the store when we started, so I had to not be driving behind the wheel. I had to be parked in the parking lot.
We can hardly hear you.
Okay, so I'm in the Defender 130 Outbound. So far, we have loved this vehicle. Okay, so we got it came on Tuesday, like the day after Christmas, and it replaced the Escalade. And so this was something we wanted to try. I wanted more time in it. I got time in it at Destination Defender, but I didn't get enough time to like do anything with it. Okay, I have put all my kids, I have put all of our gear, I have put luggage, part of a Christmas tree, stockings, Santa sleigh stuff, all the things in the back of this. It is so much bigger than the other Defender that I drove that I was like, oh my gosh. I mean, it is a 5-seater. Probably, if you did not want any leg space, it could be a 7-seater. But so far, it's been my favorite Defender out of the lineup. This one goes right at 84. So a nice mid-tier price point for Defender as well.
Mid-tier, 84.
Well, for it, but I mean, it is the brand. It is the brand. I know. I can hear David now. I hear you. I felt your vibe, even though I couldn't see you on the screen. I felt.
I think Roosevelt put the, you spell that M-I-D hyphen T-E-A-R, mid-tier.
Yeah, those prices will make me cry too.
My God. What's the estimated economy, Teia? I know it gets good economy if you're just sitting in a parking lot, but if you're actually driving it.
Estimated is 18.
Combined?
Combined. Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's kind of mid-tier.
It is. A lot less than 50.
So I hear that from there. Right. But it is actually on the side of these. It is actually, yeah, it's right in the middle of the lineup. So
okay. How about you, Greg?
Well, I just got out of the 2024 Acura Integra Type S. As you know, Acura had stopped making the Integra for a while and finally brought it back. And I'm here to tell you folks, this is nothing but the truth. 320 horsepower, direct injection with a turbo. It had a 6-speed manual, which I call, and Dave refers to as the millennial anti-theft device. Boatload of fun to drive. Average fuel economy was combined was 24, 21 city, 28 highway. Lots of fun to drive, great handling. The only downside to it was that the tires on it had been on the track already, so they were a little hard, and you know, the weather was cold, so they weren't exactly the best ride, but the handling was outstanding. And what Acura has done is brought back the fun to this size vehicle. A lot of people may not remember, but the Integra at one point was the Acura answer to the Civic Type R. So in that same ballpark, and I highly recommend it for those who want to have the performance experience before the brands go fully electric.
Great.
Did you get the pretty blue? What color was it?
Yes, it was that pretty blue, and my neighbors were going crazy over it. And even my granddaughter, who just got her license, was saying, oh, I've got to learn how to drive this.
Yes.
And I just looked at her like, you know, you're only 17. Don't come see me until you're at least 21.
Dave.
Roosevelt.
What did you have?
Most recently, Roosevelt, I had the Ford Escape plug-in hybrid. And I'll tell you what, the Escape is just a very, very nice footprint, especially if you're one of those that rely on some sort of other transportation for commuting, or you work from home and are you looking for that one do-everything type of car. An Escape is an awfully nice footprint envelope in which to do that. Escapes begin at about $30,000. It's a compact crossover. But in plug-in hybrid form, as equipped, this was $47,000. Now, there are some federal and possibly state incentives that will bring that cost down. But what you see on the window sticker in the showroom is a $47,000 car with about 35 miles of all-electric range, which is the key to the plug-in aspect, as well as 40 miles per gallon or so combined if you're driving it as a gas vehicle, which after 35 miles and no charging capability you'd have. For a lot of commutes, 35 miles of all EV is perfect. And then if you want to get out of town over the weekend, drive at 40 miles per gallon, you can do that and have really all the utility a family of four would need. I'm not completely sold on a $47,000 price point given this content. Plug-in hybrids are expensive to manufacture because there's a lot under the hood. But I'm not sure I'm sold on the $47,000 if I were in a Ford showroom. I'd probably go with the all battery electric Mustang Mach-E for that same money. And on those weekends that I did want to get out of town and I was going more than the 250-mile range of the Mach-E, I'd rent something. But yeah, it's a credible automobile for people that want that duality. And at $47,000, I'd argue it's roughly the average transaction price of a new car today. So it shouldn't blow too many people away based on that context.
Great. Well, you can go to AutoNetwork.com, take a look at the Grand Highlander, my review of the Highlander. I don't want to take up the time from the other panelists because I want to try and get into some 2023 comments and some 2024, maybe projections for 2024. So go to AutoNetwork.com, check out the 2024 Grand Highlander Toyota.
Was it as grand as you'd hoped it would be?
It was real big. That grand.
Fair enough. It is big. It is big.
It is one huge three-row automobile, and I actually did a short on it about getting in and out. Because even as big as it is, it's not easy to get in and out of the, especially the third row. So I have a short up showing you how to do that, or how I tried to do it. And Kia, yeah, I was in the back seat, but there wasn't a whole lot of butt action either. So what can I say?
Well, you know, life. Okay.
Well, let's talk a little bit about 2023. Tell me what one or two things that you all found interesting in 2023. How about you, Dawn?
for me, it was how fast it went.
you must have been having fun.
Sometimes it was a little stressful too, but I just couldn't believe how time flew. I was like, what is really going on? But I was able to like reach a couple of my milestones and stuff, but I just thought it's just like, I'm like, is this real? Am I like in a Twilight Zone? You know?
See, that's what happens when you socialize with us on this show. Time flies when you're having fun.
Yeah, it does. True.
Greg, how about yourself?
For me, it was the strike, the UAW strike against the Detroit 3. I thought that was a very monumental move by the labor movement, and it also forced the Detroit 3 to really reassess how they're going to relate to their workforce as they convert to EVs. And they all took a hit, no doubt about it, and I think that'll have some ramifications as we go forward for 2024, 25, and 26 models in terms of delaying rollouts and what can really be achieved versus what somebody in an office thinks should be achieved. And as far as the UAW is concerned, they had a big victory because they got serious wage increases and protected the pension rights of a lot of their workers. So to me, that was one of the more interesting things of this of 2023 in terms of where the auto industry is going.
Mm-hmm. How about you, Teia?
I think we got to see everybody's version of an EV. Just about everybody had some version of an EV, and we saw that not everybody's ready for it in 2023. Even though the push has been going, we got to see more of that ramp up, and then people were like, I got one. And then the strike happened. So it's kind of like, okay, pause for the effect. We'll see what happens next. But I think that Greg was right on that. I think we're going to see the effects of that strike for the next few years. And also that we're still dealing with the effects of like that COVID like period, like the COVID lockdowns. We still have the lingering effects of that. So I think more of 2023 showed me that how nobody's an island and no manufacturer's an island. They all either got to come together or they're not going to survive.
Dave.
Roosevelt, I'm going to climb on to what both Greg and Teia suggested. Obviously, the UAW labor action not only represents a win for labor at auto plants, but I think for the most part, it was a pretty credible attempt at bringing the very real-world problems of the middle class and lower middle class to the entire nation. There was a visibility factor in a discussion of those issues that really hadn't taken place short of a labor strike. So the net, you know, as to whether it goes beyond the UAW itself is still up for debate, but at least the conversation has been taking place in areas that it hadn't taken place previously or was unsuccessful, such as the import plants that are now building cars in the U.S. throughout the Southeast. You know, Volkswagen is a classic example, hasn't unionized, yet the parent company in Germany is not only fully union, but they've got decent union representation on the company board. So you'd think a couple of those feet would fall in an ongoing discussion of unionization for non-union environments, but you have to wait and see. And then on the EV subject, as Teia touched on, you've got the pause at this point in time with regard to a lot of EV planning, if not actually put off for another day. It's maybe the expectations have been reduced and we're going to see a more timely rollout of battery plants and new models, specifically at GM, that won't take place quite as quickly as they thought. Customers are kind of reevaluating their priorities, recognizing the limitations of the infrastructure. I got to tell you, in my experience with EVs of late, as we get into winter and cooler temperatures, those estimated ranges on the window stickers are worth about as much as the window stickers itself. So 250 miles quickly becomes 200. If you're driving a plug-in hybrid that suggests 26 miles of all electric range, you'll be lucky to get 20. And so there's, I think, a lot of reevaluation. And not wanting to talk into 2024, I guess I'll leave it.
Don't do that. Thank you. You know, there are a couple of things. I agree with you all about the EV. I was surprised at how fast the manufacturers start hitting the brakes and putting it in reverse when it comes to producing EVs. But I think from my standpoint, one of the things that really shocked me was how much the sales force in the dealerships weren't prepared to start selling cars after COVID. Mm-hmm. They were pretty much, during the COVID period, they were pretty much order takers. So, you know, you came in, this is the car. If you don't want it, move over to the next seat or hit the door because there's somebody right behind you that's going to spend the money for this car. And as a result of that, you know, sales, they're starting to pick up. But I think EV sales are really suffering as a result of that because you're finding the salespeople have to get back in the mindset just to sell a traditional gasoline car, which they tend to have forgotten. And as you know, the turnover at auto dealerships is still very high, and that didn't help the situation at all. Now, I think you're going to find that the dealerships are going to have to spend more time training salespeople to sell EVs. And that's a double whammy for them. If they can't sell the gasoline versions, now you're talking about those cars going away. The EVs are going to, as we all know, they're starting to back up in the on the dealership's lots already. And I can move into 2024, but I'm going to let Dave go right into 2024 with what he was about to say. Well, go
ahead, Dave. I'm not sure I'm prepared. I'll tell you what, as you talk about the retail environment, Roosevelt, Tina woke up one morning, my wife, and suggested that she'd like a new Jeep Grand Cherokee. She does this every 17 years. And I say, you know, you're driving an 06 that's completely reliable. Why in God's name would we need to spend that money? And then she reminded me that most of it is her money. So we went to the Jeep dealership and bought a new Grand Cherokee 4xe. And I think the salesman there was seasoned. The management staff was experienced. And the process, for all intents and purposes, was about as considerate and as straightforward as you'd hope. And we're happy with the car. But these people do not know how to return a phone call or respond to a text. There's one small issue with the Grand Cherokee we were hoping to get some clarification on. And two attempts to get a hold of our salesperson resulted in absolutely nothing. So a visit, again, very cordial, very straightforward, improved communication a bit. But to your point with regard to retail environments, training, I think the UAW ought to unionize the showrooms. At that point, multiple wages, you'd have shorter hours, and you might have an employment structure that suggests some longevity, some investment in the profession, and making it a career rather than a stop between other opportunities.
Interesting.
Yeah, I agree with you there. You know, we, Dave and I both sold cars. I think they've sold them for longer than I did, but the experience is something that I think everybody should go through if they're going to look to have a career in sales. Because as a car salesperson, you're up against everybody. You're up against management in the store who you would think would want you to be successful mm-hmm. because they make more money, but they're not a whole lot of help in a lot of cases. You have the customer that comes in that doesn't trust you. You're competing against every other salesperson on the sales floor for that customer base. Mm-hmm. It is like having your own business within an organization, and you have to treat yourself like a business, which means you have to go out, beat the bushes, use the technology, especially the technology today. You would think that salespeople in dealerships would be using it the technology today to really improve their social skills, like returning phone calls. I mean, you can do that on a laptop. You can do that on an iPad.
I think I've said this before. In the last few years, about since COVID, Tina and I think have bought 5 vehicles, RVs, trucks, whatever, and sold them. We haven't kept them. We don't have them in our driveway. But be that as it may, I think there was one thank you communication from those 5 transactions. And an email, my God, I used to hand write the thank you notes, stick a stamp and put it in the mail. I mean, that didn't take no effort, but it took a little bit of time. You could crank out a 100-word email in 30 seconds. And if it's a boilerplate, it would take less than that. And we haven't even gotten that. As I said, I think there ought to be a wholesale revision of how the showroom approaches the customer.
But this is literally how, like Hyundai and their Amazon partnership, this is how you start to get things like that start to develop and start to rise up, because people are looking for an alternative experience than what they're having.
Yeah. Has Jeff Bezos ever sold cars? I know he sold books.
No. Well, actually, somebody did try it before Hyundai did. Who was it? Was it?
Costco does it.
Costco. Mm-hmm. That I've had more people write in to like for on our site about the great experience they've had with Costco, but it's mm-hmm. literally like almost like buying anything else at Costco.
Well, so, Costco's a referral program to member
deals. Right. Yeah,
and they make it very straightforward.
Well, Amazon is pretty much that as well. It's a referral program to the dealer, because the dealer has to actually sell the automobile.
Sell the car.
Right. Yeah.
But you might end up with a better vetted system where you can control some of how people behave to a certain
degree. Great. Did you ever get a new car for your wife?
I think he's frozen.
She got it on her own. Basically, we got it through a lease deal.
Excellent. What did you get?
She ended up with a 2023 Venza, but we named Ruby Baby.
Oh, I love that one.
Because it's ruby red, and it took 9 months for it to be delivered after we put the order in.
Ruby Baby?
Ruby Baby.
But, Ruby Baby.
Is that on your plate?
It's ruby red, and it took 9 months to deliver it. Excellent. No, you know, too cheap for a vanity plate in Georgia.
So... At the dealership, when they raise the door and take off the wraps, do you slap it on the butt? No, I guess not.
No, they slapped us on the butt because they took our money.
Yeah, right.
Wait, that was a nice choice.
Let's move on into 2024 to continue the conversation. What are some of the things you all are looking to do in the first quarter of 2024? Not only with what you're currently doing in your business, but also what you think will happen in the industry. Dawn.
Go, Dawn. Go.
Okay, so for my business, I really was... Okay, so I've been talking about this car that I have, right? With 160,000 miles, a car that I love. So I actually want to put some effort into learning more about this car, because even when I get a new car, I don't want to get rid of this one. So I want to take some classes, and I want like some mechanic classes, and I want to learn how to do like oil changes, tune-ups, so I can like fix my own car or keep the maintenance up on my own car. And also while I'm doing that, I think it'd be a good idea for me to like showcase what I'm doing on my platforms, so I can tap into like a different audience as well as the one that I already have. So that I really, really want to do that. And as far as like the industry, can you like explain what you mean as far as like what I want to do in it? Or,
well, I think you covered what you would like to do personally with your business, which I think is a good idea.
Yeah, I really want. I'm really excited about that.
Yeah, that. As a matter of fact, the whole industry from the technician standpoint is trying to get more females in that business. And there are a couple of websites, I can't think of the name of them right now, that are female owned, and they do offer classes on repairing your own automobile. So you may want to do a search.
I would even like to get that in there, like, because I need a new paint job. If I could like, you know, get into a class where I can actually help paint with the paint job, I think that'd be kind of awesome too. That might be pushing it a little bit, but I really want to do that.
And when I was talking about the industry itself, what do you think, or what do you see happening in the first quarter of 2024 from an industry standpoint with the manufacturers, et cetera?
That's a good question. I've been like really focusing on like what Tesla's been doing. So I'm really interested in seeing what's going on with that. With the whole, I know you guys said you didn't see it, but how like the whole robot thing or whatever. I don't know if it's going to be like a downfall for them or what. That's just my own opinion, but it's so much stuff keep happening with this like company. I want to know like where it's going to go. So that's what I've been kind of focusing on.
All right, Greg.
For me, I would like to continue doing automobiles, but grow my documentary business, which I find is very relieving to be able to tell stories in a long form. As for the industry, I'm going to be tracking a couple of things. One, where we're going to find more infrastructure to support EVs. I've been reading more and more stories. In fact, I saw something this morning on one of the social media sites, people talking about their experiences driving EVs over the holidays and the big challenge finding places to charge their vehicles. And I'm wondering why places like Bucky's and Flying J and some of the other big brands, Racetrack, aren't putting in EV chargers there. To me, that's a great way to get someone into your store and buy a lot of impulse items while they're waiting for the car to charge. And anybody who's ever been to a Bucky's will tell you, you can't go in there without spending another extra $10 or so on something else. That's one thing. The other thing, I'm really pushing to see what the auto industry does is, as we talked about, the area of technicians, because there's a sweet space available for those who want to set themselves up as EV techs. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe come together as a group and create a clean room where they can do battery restorations and so forth. And it's something that can be done almost anywhere. It doesn't need a whole lot of space, but it can be an opportunity to create careers for folks that were normally, you know, sort of left out of the process.
How about you, Teia?
As far as the industry, what I'm looking for, I want to see how the brands bounce back. I want to see what some of the responses are to the strike and see how some of the brands that took, we'll call them culture hits, respond and come back up and bring themselves back to wherever and next and do whatever comes next with them. I want to see that. I want to see where this push. I want to see more hybrids. I actually want to see how that evolves as we start watching how they roll out this rolling infrastructure for EVs, because we are headed that direction, but we're not going to be headed there as fast if we can't get the infrastructure fixed. And as far as my business, the world is the oyster. It's literally what comes next. I'm looking forward to seeing some of the new vehicles come out. I'm also looking for more community partnerships, to where there's an education piece and then the piece where you bring in the brand to come teach people about it. I think that's a lot of what comes next, is people have got to learn what to do with the vehicles and that fear factor or angst factor that comes in with this new technology happening so fast, to get some of that moved on so that people aren't scared of it and you know what to do with what you have and what's coming next.
Great.
Kind of playing around. Dave, go for it.
I probably keep it simple. I think we, as a both personally and professionally, if you like automobiles and automotive topics as much as I do, I think it's time to rekindle that enthusiasm among a larger swath of the populace. I see auto shows in decline. I don't know that that needs to be a permanent condition. I see, as Teia well knows, I see journalist events targeting the automobile among journalists, like Texas Auto Writers Truck Rodeo. The State Fair is an example in Texas of a media day that ain't. And to my way of thinking, we ought to bang the drum a little more loudly, a little more steadily, to reawaken people's excitement for what automobiles give us. And while I know we don't have space particularly for a book review, Roosevelt, and I don't have that book with me, at some point I'd like, I just finished reading a book called Cars, It's written by a British author that I think is Brian Appleyard. But anyway, it's simply Cars. It's a great social history of the automobile. And over the 125 years or so that we've had self-propelled automobile conveyances, what they've done to transform populations around the world is utterly amazing. I think that ought to be greater appreciated. And I think every major daily in this country ought to have an automotive beat reporter that writes about something other than Tesla or the popularity of EVs or the declining popularity of EVs, as you now see. So again, I don't want to talk into 2025. So I'll leave it at that, okay?
Okay.
Well,
I need that book.
For me, from a business standpoint, I've always procrastinated about doing an automotive marketplace. And I look at some of my notes that I've been going through over the years. And I think, Dawn, you were talking about how time flies, how this year flew by. Mm-hmm. I started talking about this thing 5 years ago. To me, it seemed like it was only last year, but been procrastinating for so long, it's been about 5 years. I'm probably approaching six now to put this thing in place. And the sad part is I've had the software sitting on the shelf for at least four of those 5 years. But it requires me to get up off my old lazy butt, make some phone calls, and do some things. The other thing is I want to improve our show, this show, for the panelists, so that all of you get a lot more exposure. Like Dave was talking about the book review, I don't have a problem with having the author of that book on as a guest. I think we should, you know, we can have a variety of guests on the show as long as it stays automotive. I want to keep it on the automotive path and not go into politics, for instance, Dave. But having an author on talking about their book that's auto-related, I don't have a problem with that.
Would it be political, Roosevelt, if we were to just ask what started the Civil War?
No.
Well, you know.
It was the demise of the Model T. but anyway, man. And one other thing that I have found recently that I've been doing, as you all know, I'm hooked on technology. I like doing live stuff. And I used to be a Google Glass, whatever they called them, you know, glass holes back in the day. And now Meta has some new glasses, Ray-Ban, called Meta Glasses.
I saw them.
And I have a pair, and I've had them now for about a month, and it fascinates me what you can do with that little camera. You get a POV point of view that you just can't touch with any other camera because you don't look stupid. You look like you're wearing a pair of regular glasses, but you can actually live stream with it. I mean, you can take photos, videos, you can talk to it. You'll be able to, you can ask it, you can, like I asked the thing the other day, what's the difference between all-wheel drive and four-wheel drive? And within less than 10 seconds, the lady gave me the difference through my glasses, through the speakers on the glasses. So you're walking around. You can't be dumb. You know, it's hard. But the one thing I found about shooting video with these glasses, especially cars, it makes you focus on that particular part of the car that you're looking at. It's not like you try to zoom in. Like, you look at the difference between our video panel and Tia's video panel. With our video panel, a lot of times we'll comment about Dave's background, about what's hanging on the wall. Tia, it's pretty much focused with vertical. It's focused right on her pretty much. Mm-hmm. And I shot a walk around of a car. I think it was the Bronco. And I found it. No, it was the Grand Highlander. I wanted to try it. And I found it amazing how, to me, if I was talking about the steering wheel, that's pretty much all you saw in the frame was the steering wheel. You weren't trying to look around and see what else was on the dash. So and you move your head. You have to get used to moving your head to shoot the video. You just can't go left and right and left and right because you drive people crazy. But technology like that, from the manufacturer standpoint, it's going to be interesting to see how they move into the charging space infrastructure like everybody's been talking about. We have some oil companies now that are going to get in, that are going to get into the space in the first quarter, and I think that's going to make a big difference.
Mm-hmm.
I think consumers are going to get more education, like Teia was saying, on EVs. I think they're going to realize that I don't drive 500 miles in a week. You know, 150 miles may be good.
Yeah.
For an inexpensive small commuter car to go back and forth to work, which some of the manufacturers are going to start producing, you know, the less than $20,000 EVs. I can see something like the Fiat 500e coming back, and if they promote that thing as a commuter car,
man,
I think you'll find people even in New York purchasing it.
Well, and give it a good lease price. Mini is promoting a $239 a month on their electric with about $3,500 out of pocket. And sure, it's only got 150 mile range, but I think most people can get their head around $240 a month.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's only one appearance fee on Auto Network reports.
Well, from a leasing standpoint.
This money's off? Where is it?
Yeah, you know, from a leasing standpoint, over the holidays, there were some manufacturers who had 000 leasing, which means, you know, nothing down, no monthly payment. And if they can do it during that one special time, they can make that a standard program.
Absolutely.
When we set the credit unions up in the leasing business, it was like that from day one. No down payment. No, you know, first monthly payment wasn't due for at least 30 days, depending upon the credit union. And it was zero interest.
Mm-hmm.
So that meant once you got pre-approved, you drove off the lot without any money coming out of your pocket.
Right, right.
And that kind of stuff is doable today if they choose to do it. So somebody's going to step up to the plate and do it.
And with inventories growing, they may have to choose to
do it. To do it. Yeah.
Yeah. As long as they keep those car prices in the mid-tier, right, Teia?
Yes. Yeah. You know, they're coming. The middle of the road, okay?
Yeah.
You know, one last thing, and Dave, this is taking us into 2025, even though it's going to be sold in 2024, I believe, and that's the new Ram 2025, the Ram Charger, the pickup truck.
Yeah.
Now, I found that technology very interesting, where you only use the gasoline engine to power the generator that's in the car that sent the electricity to the front motor and the rear motor, and there is no transmission. Now that I can see in if they move that technology into cars.
Well, they've got a 165 mile all electric, I think.
All electric.
But you won't care about the range because you've got the gas engine.
Exactly.
To charge the batteries. So,
and it eliminates the concern about community housing where you don't have charging stations.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And the Automotive News did an interview. I'm not sure if it's the brand manager of that, the lead engineer on that. Anyway, having just bought this Grand Cherokee 4xe, which is set up on a completely different hybrid, plug-in hybrid system.
Right.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with what they chose to do there. But for all intents and purposes, they've just moved one generation ahead with the Ram Charger. And I would assume that that drivetrain will end up in Jeep products within the next couple of years. Right. At which I wish I had that, and we don't. And we trade every 17 years, so it'll be a while.
Well, you might slow your 17 or speed it up a little bit. You know, yeah. You might say, oh, swap.
Well, and given my age, we probably should anyway, Teia. I mean, I could be gone tomorrow.
Let's not jump down the road that far, okay?
But anyway, I think that we need to bring this to a close. 2024 will be here before we get off the show. So I want to thank everybody who watched the live presentation of AutoNetwork Reports. Again, visit the social media sites of each one of the panelists. Give them a like, a follow, or a subscribe, or all of the above. Also, I want to thank those who are watching the on-demand. And this will probably be one time where I don't have to edit out anything on the podcast. Thank you, Dave.
that Civil War question is going to fly.
Yes.
Unicorn.
Oh, good. I'm glad to hear that.
But anyway, hope you have a happy and safe, especially safe New Year's Eve, especially. Don't get out there and try and do things that your body can't. Well, anyway, just right, be nice.
Right, everybody can't handle.
Be nice, enjoy yourself,
and
happy New Year.
Nothing better to celebrate the holiday than giving an Uber a call while yourself after you celebrate. So,
exactly.
Yeah, that's what they're made for. You bet.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks.
See you next time.
Happy New Year. Bye,
buckle up. Don't drink and drive. Buckle up. Don't text and drive. Happy New Year.